under the vehicle. If the thing is from a rear detail, it shows an activity of cells and calls it off the monitor. It doesn't get a look at information itself. This is a lecture slot. These are schedule of that cell in the line, and we're looking at 50 micromolar compound in 24 hours. And you can see that you get, this is the compound inhibitor, and you get very good knockdown of global calculation. Now, I think it's not all the cell lines give you such results. And so there were plenty of reasons why you wanted to get a more potent compound, and there are also reasons why you'd like to get around to some of the features of this molecule. We have to make more things with the goal of trying to get things that are more soluble. So we can crystallize them, and so we now have several simple structures of co-complexes. And I'm putting this up, I'm going to show you a blue movie in a minute, but I want to point out a couple of things. This phenomenon of cyclical bondness is an almost perfect uridine mimic. And so if you trace the uracil ring right here, and it's the bond to the rival sugar, you can see that the overlap here is remarkable. You have the two oxygens here and the nitrogen here are almost on top of each other, and then it diverges, kind of they go off in different directions. But then this bonded oxygen and this rival comes off in position to make contact to the same group. And so we have what I think is a very good uridine mimic. And then you can also see that as this molecule progresses further, that you have actually a set of contacts with this acid overlaps reasonably well with the phosphate. Now, this is a big molecule. It does get into cells, well, the protected version, the extra protected version does, but it would be nice if it was smaller. But in looking at it, one of the reasons it's big is that it kills this part of the acid site really well. So this part is jammed in, like the uridine. And then on top of it, this part of the molecule, which we couldn't figure out what it's doing for the longest time, seems to be sort of lying on it the way part of the peptide, which they would, and then comes in under this lip. And so, I don't know how much smaller we can make it, but we did manage to find something that had good sort of electronic complementarity and good shape complementarity. And so if you play movies, and it just shows you the sort of electric envelope, again, it's a pretty nice structure. But so you can see these are a series of hydrogen bonds that are identical in the uracil. There's a sort of peptide backbone, and then there's a spiking hydrogen bond. There's a happy interaction, which this also picks up on. This is the hydrogen, the contact to the ribosidrophone. So there's a whole set of interactions, and then over here, that carboxyl group is making a set of interactions very similar to what the phosphate does. And so we have a really nice hydrogen inhibitor at this point, and we have the information that we need to make it better, and we're hoping to be able to get things which are going to be able to take channels with the help of here, change multiple readings, you can abolish these completely. And so those regions are critical. we began to study the cleavage fragments of our smaller teeth, and we found that cleavage actually occurs, and this is the first gigantic breakthrough, was that cleavage does not occur here between the threonine and the glutamate. It actually occurs between the cysteine and the glutamate. And what happens when cleavage occurs, you form the pushing N-terminal fragment, and then the C-terminal fragment, which has the pyroglutamate at the N-terminus. And so in this molecule, you have a cyclization curve through this nitrogen and this carbonyl right there. And so the reason that the cleavage fragment is identified at the initial stage is that these would not be feasible to identification as it were. And so they were detecting this was a mechanistic clue because if you're forming a pyroglutamate fast, at least, then it's going to glutamate glycine activation. So given that it happens spontaneously, but this was happening relatively quickly. And so, how did you activate the glycine? So we'll get to that, because I wanted to tell you that one of the things that we thought was that if you get a structure of this alpha OGT, it might give us more mechanistic clues, but it will also give us maybe the first view of how peptides or proteins can bind into the OGT GGR domain, because that's where it was proposed to bind. And so, if you draw a structure, you can see here, so the GDP, let us look at, and then this long HBF1 peptide binding over the sugar and then extending up into the lumen of the GGRs. So it's a pretty nice structure. And it tells us how to substrate binds OGT. So the binding, really, a lot of the interactions that anchor into the GGRs involve these bidentate hydrogen bonds from asparagines, and so they interact with the backbone. So you can see one after another, these asparagines making contact to the added backbone and positioning this molecule in the lumen of the GGRs, which is pretty neat. That kind of binding motive was there before, among other things, in the first thing called output disorder. And the GGR structure was published in the post, and this possibility is quite stable.
Get localized. So she is essential. She's knocking out of the eye of the glass, pressure the heart, and the cell can
died. And so we have to actually be able to come to that human and robustly replace the gene with other variants that can identify the ones that survive. So, with the potential, I should spend my time to measure now. Okay, so I want to thank my group and a whole bunch of other people. I won't take long steps to say that all the donations that we have up here is because of the efforts of a huge number of people and resources. And I was very fortunate to have some wonderful students. Ben Rose started this project, but I joined the NESCO and had a whole team of faculty students. Mike Lazarus, along with the structural work, he was initially helped by Peter Sneed in the BCMG department at Harvard, but he became he's now a structural biologist and now finite. He's a professor in Chile, he did a couple structural biologists. Jiayang Zhang, now the University of Wisconsin, did a lot of the mechanistic work, on the early HDF1 cleavage of this. And John Vanessa was the kind of mechanistic work where we were able to see these intermediates, and so we discovered some really beautiful mechanistic entomology, which they're ahead of. And I have a whole bunch of new students coming along who I think are doing wonderful things. I want to mention Sarah Martin right now, because she actually made the inhibitors that we crystallized, and she has been working closely with Kytomic and Human Agents, so they have been functioning really well, I think, about mini group, which these are not the easiest molecules to make, and it's going great. So I'm very grateful to them for their efforts, and I think that these are actually getting animals that they said. There's a whole bunch of other people who have to help along the way. I can't forget Mission Merck, who is spectacular with my HDF1 cleavage, and to collaborate to work out the mechanism. And of course, David Burke also I do, I'd like to show what's flying to minus Robert Dyer in Lund. And Robert Dyer, excuse me, last year, was born in 1886 in Delaware County, Ohio, and went from there to Union College in Ohio, and then was University of Texas for his MD degree. But things didn't really get good for him until he joined the USPHS for 18, and then moved on to the Hygienic Laboratory for Custer, where he was just coming. In 1906, he became a division of infectious diseases near the year, and became absolutely in the discovery of not only endemic virus, but the development of vaccines against it. From 1952 to 1950, he was director of the National Institutes of Health. The division was never called again because 1950 became the National Institutes of Health. But while here, he helped create a division of research grants, the National Heart Institute, National Institute of Research, National Institute of Health, and was involved in the planning of Flint, sir. He was the city of Doris awards, including the last award, and was one of the very first in 1957 to be involved in the publication of observations in the year. Okay. Dr. Dyer is the division college. The person we are here to honor and to hear from today. Are you guys okay? Warren Canals here. BS and master's degrees there. He's a professor of Ontario. Yeah, yeah. And went to Paris in 1996, where he came to PhD with distinction in search of real disease. He came to the United States to join the laboratory of parasitology, where he studied for 6 years before taking his career in Cincinnati in search of really the country's best chili, and was extremely successful there, but realized that the study of parasitology and immunology was incomplete without the study of microbes that drive high inflammation and chronic exposure to the environment. So he came back here in 2005 to become the head of the mucosal immunology section in the laboratory of parasitic diseases. In 2014, recognizing that microbiome was really an essential part of how he became the director of the NIAID microbiome program, and has continued to lead that through most many other things to this day. There are not sure a few things that Yasmin has not been honored for and directed, although I could not find them for this. I just want to remind you that she is on the editorial boards of the Journal of Medicine, Cell Science, and is the recent, I'm only listed in the last few years, of course, in 2017, she's not very far along. The recipient of the AAI Journal Fisher Award, the Engel-Hungarian Award, and the Snowden Institute Investor Award. She is an internationally recognized leader in the field. More importantly, she is a locally recognized leader and mentor to young and old scientists. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Yasmin Belkin.
Thank you. お前の家特定して結婚してやる。
Gracias.